right, thank you so much for joining us this morning. It's time to begin. This is our 30th graduation at Emmaus Baptist Academy and our 40th year of having a Christian school here at our church. And we have several graduates this year, and we're thankful for each family member and friend who's come today to help celebrate. We have a couple of homeschool students as well as our students who are graduating from our academy. And so we're going to stand right now. Brother Gable's going to come and lead us in a song. And then right after that, we'll have the seniors come down the aisle, and we'll have our pledges and just carry on with the program from there. Brother Gable.
All right, would you stand with me? We'll sing the song, Our Best. The words are on your bulletin as well as on the screen for you. Give me thy best. We'll just sing that first verse together.
Hear ye the master's call, give me thy best. For be it great or small, that is his
Thank you. Remain standing as the flags come in. Would you join me as we say our pledges? We'll start with the Bible and end with the American flag. Attention, salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will ever give a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will hide its words in my heart that I might not sin against God. To the Baptist flag, attention, salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the Baptist flag and to the faith once delivered unto the saints. I will ever remain faithful to the tie that binds us together, the book, the blood, and the blessed hope of our Lord's soon return. And to the American flag. Attention, salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And we'll sing our national anthem together.
Thank you.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Even though our academy is small, we have a rigorous academic program that we challenge the students with, and some students really work hard to prepare for a college prep diploma and score highly on SAT test. And we have a set of criteria, including being a godly example. And so this year we have a valedictorian who's going to come and give a speech on behalf of the senior class, and that is Leah Rohn. So give her your attention as she comes.
On behalf of the graduating class of 2023, I would like to thank each and every one of you for taking the time to celebrate with us today. I would also like to express special thanks to all of the staff and volunteers who worked so hard to help us get a good and godly education. You've all sacrificed so much of your lives in order to teach us, and we trust that God will not forget your work and labor of love. It would take hours to list every person who has impacted our lives, but because we don't have hours, I'll take only a few minutes to thank a couple of people. Thank you, Ms. Follett, for faithfully teaching kindergarten. You instilled in me and in many other students a love for learning. Thank you, Mrs. Lytle, for not only teaching elementary for many years, but also for teaching chapel. I know many of us have fond memories of the years we were in chapel. Thank you, Mrs. Hammett, for not only being a great elementary teacher, but for the many years you have volunteered at school. Thank you, Mr. Anger, for being so much more than just a math teacher. You invested in each of our lives individually so that we could succeed not only academically, but also spiritually. Thank you, Mr. Follett, for being a faithful servant to this school. We will never forget how much you sacrificed in order to get us through last school year. Thank you, Pastor Gable and Pastor Roland, for your ministry to us teens. We are so blessed to have had your sound Bible teaching throughout the past 6 years of our schooling. We are truly thankful that God has placed you in our lives. I would also like to thank our parents for doing so much for us so that we could be here today. We thank you for the many sacrifices you have made for us. We recognize that we are truly blessed by God to have had so many opportunities to hear the truth. Many in public school will never hear about the God who loves them, but we have been blessed to hear that message almost every day. We are thankful for this church, for this school, and for our families that have taught us the truth. They have shown us, through God's word, who God is, who we are, and how we should live. We are also thankful for a God who is good and loving and forgiving. Those words may sound cliche, but they are true. God not only sent his son to die for us so that we can have a relationship with him, he also gave us the Bible so that we can know about him and that sacrifice he made. And he also gave us the Holy Spirit to teach and convict us of our need for a relationship with him. For those of us in this church, we have been given even more than these things. We have been given pastors and teachers and parents who have explained the Bible to us and who have shown us by example how to live. To those of us behind us, we desire that you would not forget what you have been taught. It is so easy in a Christian environment to act the part and go with the flow. But even though that may be easier, that will not be fulfilling. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path." We implore you to follow this advice. Trust in God, delight yourself in him, make him your first priority, and that will give you the joyful and fulfilling life you long for. We ask all of you to pray with us as we seek to trust God with our day-to-day life. The road ahead of us may seem uncertain, but we know God has a good plan for our lives. Thank you.
Thank you. enjoyed the message of those songs, and I trust you were able to hear and think about what they were singing about. Young people are going to actually head down now and get in place to place a couple of handbell songs. Appreciate Brother Gable leading the teen choir and Jillian Malitsky leading the handbell choirs. And we have two choirs, a younger junior high choir that's learning, and then a varsity choir, if you want to call it that. And I appreciate that they've been practicing for years on these handbells. This year, thankfully, with COVID behind us, we were able to go to several nursing homes around Christmas time and do some ministry performances. And then they've been preparing the last several weeks for this graduation. The title of these two songs that they're going to do for us now, let me see here. O God, Our Help in Ages Past will be the first one. And then after that is He Leads Me Day by Day. I want you to be patient, because in between each song, they're going to have to move the choirs out, move the new choir in, get some handbells ready. And then right after that, the senior class is going to come up and sing a special. So there'll be some movement between these next few songs. Just be patient, and let's pay attention and enjoy their music.
People appreciate that, and it's my pleasure today to introduce our commencement speaker, and we're so glad that George could be with us today. Of course, many of you know that his family, he and his family minister in the country of South Africa as missionaries, and God's allowed them to be here for a season of time. They're headed to the field, Lord willing, in just a couple of weeks, and so we're glad that George could be with us today to speak, and we say that because he's had a few unexpected events in the last few days. So we really are very grateful he could be here today, and trust that you'll open your hearts and give him your attention as he brings the Word of God to us today. So it's all yours.
Thank you, and good morning, and thank you for your attendance today. It's a blessing to be able to have this opportunity. Today is really a special day. For each one of these graduates sitting down here, I know it's a special day for you. It's a special day for me and my wife, for our family, and as we graduate the second one of ours, and ask me where the time goes, and I don't know. The years fly by really quickly, but we're just delighted for the opportunity. Thank you for each one that's come out today to be a part of the celebrations and join with us in that. I'd like to direct your attention for just a few moments this morning, and we'll try to keep it to the morning. I don't intend to be long today, but I never intend to be long, so I don't always do what I intend. But this is such an important occasion. I believe it's of utmost importance to bring the wisdom of the Word of God to the moment and to this hour. Especially, most of the comments that I want to address this morning will be in particular for the graduating class. But I believe there's relevance in these things for each and every one of us. And so I appreciate your attention this morning. The Bible says, Jesus said in Matthew 6 and verse 33, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." And in the context of Matthew chapter 6 is what we commonly refer to as the Sermon on the Mount. It is the longest recorded sermon of the Lord Jesus Christ that we have preserved for us in the pages of the Word of God. And in this particular part of the sermon in Matthew chapter 6, Jesus is giving us wisdom as it relates to the priorities and the choices of life. We'll talk about that a little bit this morning. I don't know about you graduates. If you haven't been asked the question yet, just brace yourself, but it's probably coming. What are your plans now that you're done with high school? They're all smiling at me. It's not a bad question, and it's not really necessary that you probably have your 10-year plan ready to deliver to every curious inquirer today and in the next few weeks. But honestly, it is a good question to reflect on. And it's one that I'm sure probably each of you have already pondered to some degree or another. If you don't have it all figured out yet, that's okay. You're at an exciting point in the journey of your life. As you're here today, you really have the opportunity to take in a fresh perspective on the path of your life. You can look back on what you have accomplished. You can look forward into the future and try to imagine how the path will unfold. Maybe this morning you're filled with excitement and big dreams. Maybe you're a little bit fearful of the uncertainty that is ahead. There's really two words that come to the top of my mind when I think about the juncture of life that each of you are faced with today. I think of the word priorities, and I think of the word choices. What are the things that you really want to get out of life, and what are the best choices to help you achieve those priorities? What are the dreams that you have today? What do you want to become? What do you hope to be able to look back in 20, 30, 40 years, look back and say, I have accomplished this with my life? We must be very careful with the priorities that drive our life, because the priorities that you embrace will impact and ultimately will define the sum total of your life. It's really kind of sobering when you begin to reach the end of life and you look back and you say, what is the measure of my life? The list of potential priorities that could shape your life is really an endless list. Sometimes we call it a bucket list. People have bucket lists, lots of things they hope to accomplish before their time on this earth is finished. You could prioritize your education. Maybe some of you have plans to go on to further education, get a degree. Maybe you're going to prioritize your career or making money or travel or sports or food or pleasure. Really, the list goes on and on. It's nice to have priorities and goals. It's a whole nother thing to know what choices should I make to help me reach those goals. Everybody probably could say, when I graduated high school, I wanted to be rich. Who wants to be a millionaire? Well, it's one thing to want it. It's another thing to figure out how to get it. Priorities and choices. You know, the list of choices for your life to achieve the goals that you have is really another endless list, because life is full of variables and unknowns. None of these priorities that I mentioned are intrinsically wrong, but if any of them stand as the defining priority of your life, I promise you they will leave you disappointed, empty-handed, and full of eternal regret. There's nothing wrong with the goal of wanting to enjoy your life and however that stands out to you, but the problem is if that is what you focus on at the end of the road, it won't be what you thought it was going to be. Solomon described the pursuit of all of these things at the end of his life as vanity. So this is a good moment right now in your life to assess what should be the biggest priority of my life? And then in turn, what are the choices that I need to make to turn that priority into a reality that is realized instead of just a hope-so dream that slips through your fingers? The most profound counsel and perspective I believe that you could ever gain and glean is the wisdom from the words of Jesus Christ himself. Jesus, in fact, leaves no room for confusion or doubt concerning what he defined as the greatest priority of life. In Matthew 6:33, we heard his words. Jesus said, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God." Sadly, many in this world are so consumed with pursuing their own dreams, defining their own truth, and creating their own kingdom that they are oblivious to the absolute importance of seeking after the kingdom of God. Yet Jesus Christ places this pursuit of God's kingdom as the highest priority of life. This morning, you might well ask the question, what does it mean to seek the kingdom of God? And in the greater context of Matthew 6, Jesus instructs us concerning three important choices that must be made if we would succeed at seeking the kingdom of God. I want to briefly give them to you this morning, and I'm going to be very respectful of your time, but I trust you'll give me your attention for just the next 10 minutes and think about three choices that the Lord Jesus says, if you will choose these things, it will help you to fulfill and to establish the priority of seeking the kingdom of God. In Matthew 6 and verse 19, in this context, Jesus says these words, "Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." Jesus here very succinctly divides treasure into two categories. There's treasures of the earth, and there's treasures of heaven. You know, there's many varied treasures on this earth, and they all have this in common. Every earthly treasure is temporal. Whether your treasure is money, whether your treasure is your career, whether your treasure is your family, whether your treasure is getting some notable degree or honor bestowed upon you, whatever your treasure may be, if you seek the treasures of this earth, they have it in common. All the treasures of this earth are temporary. The treasures that belong to the next life, those treasures that Jesus calls heavenly treasures, are altogether different because they are eternal. They cannot be taken away. They cannot be corrupted. Jesus uses this language to describe the treasures of this earth. And it resonates with us because every one of us knows it in the depth of our being that this is absolutely true. Jesus Christ is speaking truth when he says the treasures of this earth are easily corrupted by moth and rust. We know that's the case. You know, you can lay up in your 401k, you can invest in your stocks and bonds, you can make great financial decisions, and it can all be turned upside down in a moment. Maybe you keep it all of your life and you enjoy it to the fullest, to the end of your days. And then your life is finished. They take your body, we bury you in the ground, and what happens to all of your treasures? They don't go with you. The treasures of this life are temporal. They're corruptible and they're compromisable. When we get treasures, we then have to take measures to protect our treasures because we know that somebody else is going to see our treasure and maybe they're going to come try to take it away from us. And so Jesus says, listen, don't spend all of your time laying up treasures on this earth where all that you can expect is for these things to corrupt and be taken away. And then the worst part of it is that your treasures eventually consume your very heart. Jesus said in verse 21, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. This is perhaps the worst thing about pursuing earthly treasure, is that it captivates our soul. And we end up selling our soul for things that are temporal, things that cannot really bring us lasting pleasure, joy, and fulfillment and purpose in this life. And yet we live our life, we spend our days to pursue that for which leaves us wanting and lacking an eternal reward. You know, the treasures that are valued in the kingdom of God are altogether different. If you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, you might scratch your head and you might say, "Preacher, that just sounds a little bit strange. I mean, isn't that what we're supposed to do in life? Go out, be successful, get a good job, make some money, provide for your family, enjoy some good things. There's nothing wrong with that. Yes, that is part of the function of life. But when the treasures of this world captivate your soul, they steal your attention and draw you away and distract you from the treasure that Jesus defines as heavenly treasure, which is treasure indeed. You know, the treasures that are eternal, that are laid up in heaven, we would refer to some of these as the Word of God. That's an eternal treasure. The worship of God, the will of God and doing it with your life, the gospel of God, that Christ has died for your sins. He was buried and he raised again. To know him is to know eternal life. These are just a few of the high commodity treasures in the kingdom of God. And my counsel, Jesus' counsel to you today, as you ponder the priorities of your life, you say, what should be the most important priority? In the words of Jesus, it is to seek the kingdom of God. You say, how can I seek the kingdom of God? Well, you need to make the choice for the right treasure, number one. Choose eternal, heavenly treasure. If you choose the wrong treasure, the problem is you're going to make the mistake, number two, and choose the wrong master. Jesus says in verse 24 these words, no man can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. And then he says it very plainly, you cannot serve God and mammon. Period. It's an emphatic statement. It's declarative. Jesus is revealing truth. He says, where your treasure is, that's where your heart will be also. If your heart is tied to earthly treasure, you give your earthly days, the life that God gives you, the intellect, the wisdom, the abilities, the talents, you take it, you invest it to pursue in the earthly treasures of this life, you're making a mistake because you're giving your heart for the earthly treasures that are corruptible. And Jesus says they steal your heart because you can't serve them and God at the same time. How many people have I known at the end of their life with such regret? They've lived their life and they've been successful, wildly successful, as the world would describe success. And one could envy the things that they've achieved. One could be envious of their degrees. One could be envious of their position. One could be envious of the respect and the honor that they enjoy among the professional colleagues of their work environment. One could be envious of all the toys and houses and possessions. And yet, when you realize at the end of life, when it all comes down to the end and all of those treasures slip through their fingers, and they have not invested in heavenly treasure, they have made the greatest mistake of all. When you choose the wrong treasure, you choose the wrong master. We don't usually like to think in terms of being under a master. In fact, maybe some of you sitting here on the front row this morning are thinking, now I'm done with school. I don't have any more teachers. I get to be my own boss. Yeah. Let me know how that works out. You'll always have masters in this life. It's kind of condescending and demeaning to think about it, but it really is the truth. I could list who your masters will be. We'll just leave that for your imagination. But you will have masters. Always be somebody that you will be responsible to please. And if you don't please them, there will be consequences. There will be fallout. Jesus here is really speaking, though, about the master of your heart. Who's in charge of your decisions? You know, many have made the mistake of thinking that they are in charge of their own life. And that's why they pursue whatever they want to pursue. That's why they define their own truth. That's why they choose their own goals. That's why they pursue their own priorities. And yet, this is a great tool used by the devil to deceive us, because the truth is, no one of us is in charge of our own life. Occasionally, God reminds us that we, in fact, do not have any power over our life like we think we do. Sunday morning was one of those occasions for me. I had every intention of being in church on Sunday morning. And the Lord said, no, I think I'll let you experience something else. I woke up, went to the hospital, and got to have operation. You know, I didn't pick that. That wasn't what was on my to-do list for the day. And God just gently reminded me, you're not in charge of your life. You know, we live in a generation that highly values the right to be in charge of their own life. I think everybody really values that deep down. This is a struggle of human nature. But the truth is that we're all serving a master. You might say, I will live for myself. I will do the things that I want to do. Well, in the words of Christ, if that's your philosophy of life, then you are a servant to your own lust. You may be doing exactly what you want to do, but you are serving your lust. This is a great tool that the devil uses to convince many that the way to live your best life is to choose your own treasure, be your own master. And nothing could be further from the truth. If you would prioritize and value the kingdom of God, I tell you this morning, it is vital that you would make the choice to willingly appoint Christ to be the master of your life. There's many, many masters that you could choose to serve. Christ is the only one who deserves your allegiance. The last choice that you must make, not only to choose the right treasure, choose the right master, but choose the right kingdom. And I'm finished. In verse 33, we already read it. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. This is really the climax point of this passage of Scripture. This isn't, in fact, it's such a familiar verse. You may say, oh, Brother George, I know that. I've heard that. I memorized that when I was 5 years old in Sunday school. I hope the truth of the power of the truth of this verse is not lost on you. This verse, you can meditate on it for the rest of your life. It will continually challenge you, because Jesus here is emphasizing that the kingdom of God should be our highest priority. And at the same time, he's emphasizing that there is a distinct choice that must be made. And it's a very individual, very personal choice that you must make to enter into the kingdom of God, that you must make to seek the kingdom of God. And all of it hinges on seeking his righteousness. You know, the truth of the Bible is that we are not automatically counted as citizens of God's heavenly kingdom. That may come as a surprise to some of you sitting here today. Not everyone. We're not automatically born into the kingdom of God. Quite to the contrary, the Bible would tell us. We're born into another kingdom. Jesus said in John 3:3, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. You know, there's an open invitation. It's not exclusive that God restricts anybody from coming to his kingdom. In fact, Jesus said, whosoever will may come. Jesus invites you into his kingdom. He wants you in his kingdom. It's your opportunity, but it's up to you which kingdom will you choose. The truth is, you only gain access and citizenship into the kingdom of God when you seek first the righteousness of God. That's what Jesus says is the key that gains you access into his kingdom. You must be clothed in the righteousness of God alone if you would be granted access and citizenship into his kingdom. You can't pray enough, be good enough. You went to EBA. That's nice. That doesn't put you in the kingdom of God. You're raised in a Christian home. That's wonderful. I'm glad you have loving parents who are teaching you good moral biblical values. That's not sufficient to put you into the kingdom of God. You can try hard enough, it won't be sufficient. You can join the right organization, that won't help you. The only access into the kingdom of God for any one of us will be if you are clothed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. That's what he says. Amen. Seek his righteousness. He hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. My question for you this morning is this. As you sit here, you look at the path of life ahead of you, you got a lot of things to think about, a lot of changes coming up. You're going to be pondering these kind of questions. What do I want to do with my life? It's my prayer. It's my desire that each of you would understand and really, in the depths of your soul, really lay hold of this truth. The greatest priority that you can pursue with your life is to seek the kingdom of God. You do that by choosing the right treasure, choosing the right master, and choosing the right kingdom. Our prayers are with each of you that God's best and his blessing would be upon you, that you would choose wisely. God is a good God. He doesn't force us to do anything. The path is open before you. Many paths you can take, but only one, if you seek the kingdom of God, will be fulfilling and eternally rewarding. Can we pray together? Thank you, Heavenly Father, for this time today. Thank you for each one of these graduates that has accomplished this point in their life. I thank you for each of them, and we are excited about what you have in store for them and their future. Father, we thank you for the words of Christ that give us wisdom. We need wisdom. I need wisdom. We live in a confused world. We live in a time where people don't know the difference between right and wrong. I take the time to dig in and pay attention. Help us to listen to the wise counsel and command of Christ today to seek first the kingdom of God. We ask your blessing now on the remainder of these proceedings and on the days ahead for each one of these graduates. May they love you and serve you with all of their life, we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. Mr. Anger, thank you.
Yeah, I appreciate that message, Brother George. Good challenge for each one of us, not just the seniors. Good challenge for them as well, of course. And at this time, we are going to be meeting each of our graduates. And we have a video with some recorded testimony that they've given, telling their story a little bit, and answering that question, what they plan to do after high school, right? And then there's some pictures that their parents and they have chosen to go with the video. I have to point out, and I do this every year, but we don't take the effort like a documentary to make sure the picture matches with what they're saying. So it's just, we'll put them together, enjoy the pictures, but don't let it distract you from what they're saying. Listen to their stories. And then after that, I will have each senior come up here and we'll give them their diploma and switch their tassel. And at that point, parents, be aware they have a rose to give to mom. So you'll come right down here and greet them and get your rose. And then we'll meet the next senior. So our first senior that we're going to meet this afternoon is Anna Nicole Hammett. So let's listen as we watch her video.
My name is Anna Hammett. I was born in Polokwane, South Africa, and have grown up primarily on the mission field. When I was in second grade, I attended EBA for a few quarters with my brother. I have enjoyed the privilege of being able to attend various different classes these past 3 years we've been back. Certainly, the Lord's hand has been very evident in my life over the past few years, not the least of which was being able to attend Brother Anger's chemistry class. I have attended handbells, choir, PE, and chapel. I have enjoyed the Baptist history class that Pastor Gable taught this year, as well as the worldviews class last year taught by Pastor Roland. Having grown up around the Bible and the truth of the gospel, I always viewed myself as a good kid. I heard the gospel many times, but in all those times, I never wanted to accept the fact that it applied to me. In 2017, when I was around 11, the Lord started getting a hold of my heart and attention. There was a series of messages preached on the end times. The fear of hell and the conviction of the Holy Spirit moved me to get serious about dealing with my relationship with God. I began to seek for help from my parents. I struggled for a while with truly yielding everything to Him in repentance. Often I would pray for salvation, but each time I did so, I knew it was not genuine, as I was still proudly thinking I was good enough for God to accept into heaven. However, on April 1st, 2018, I came to the Lord in humility and surrendered my life to the Lord and asked Him to come into my heart. Since that time, my attitude towards the Bible and God have changed. He is now my Lord, and I want to serve Him with my life. I would now like to thank a few of the many people who have invested in my life. Mom and Dad, thank you for all you have put into my schooling and how much you have sacrificed for me. Mom, thank you for all the work you have done in times when it was difficult for you. Thank you for making us your priority and being there for us. Thank you for being patient with me and encouraging me to do my best in everything. Yes, even in history. Dad, thank you for being my math teacher, science teacher, accounting overseer, principal, father, and friend. Thank you for your patience with me and for giving your time and sanity to walk me through the physical science course page by page. Joel, thank you for helping me through the remainder of the chemistry year and being a close friend. Luke, thank you for being the ever-present fellow conspirator in just about everything. I will greatly miss getting distracted from our studies together. Thank you, Mr. Enger, for teaching chemistry and never being too busy to answer a question. Thank you, Pastor Roland and Pastor Gable, for your love for me and the time you have invested in my life. Thank you, Mrs. Lytle, for teaching us the truths of God at a young age and for being a godly example to me. Thank you, Miss Kristen, for the trips you have taken to visit us in South Africa, for teaching my brothers and me piano, for making me learn classical music, and for always being willing to listen and give counsel to me. My plans for the short term include returning to South Africa and serving there with my family, enrolling in Bible Institute, and taking courses in graphic design. I will appreciate your prayers for me as I begin this new chapter of my life. Thank you.
To mention earlier, we'll wait for the applause until all of the seniors have gotten their diploma, and then we'll give a big round of applause for all of them. Anna, come on up. All right, now we're going to meet her cousin, Isaac Hammett, and then we'll have Pastor and Mrs. Allison come and give a diploma.
Hello, my name is Isaac Roland Hammett. I've had the privilege of being homeschooled since kindergarten. I have also been blessed to be able to take many pull-out classes from EBA during high school, like gym class, choir, and handbells. My favorite classes were small engine class, physics, and woodworking. I have also really enjoyed going to all the teen camps, singing in the KCEA choir, going on the Tim missions trips to Florida, and racing Ethan in physics to see who could answer a problem first. While my high school years have had many fun experiences, they have also been filled with a lot of spiritual turmoil. For most of these years, I struggled with my salvation, making many professions of faith, but none of them ever changed my life. Going into the summer camp of 2022, I really wanted to settle the issue of my salvation. I had recently made another profession of faith, which I thought was genuine, but I was struggling with assurance. During the Wednesday evening message at camp, God plainly pointed out that I was not right with Him because I had been trying to do salvation and the Christian life on my own by checking off all the boxes. That night, I cried out to God and told Him that I was tired of my sin and trying to do things right, and I wanted a real relationship with Him. Since that time, I have seen my life changed, and even though I have struggled with assurances of salvation, God has shown me that I am His child. I am very thankful for all those who have invested in my life to make me what I am today. Thank you, Mama, for sacrificing yourself to homeschool me for 13 years and patiently teaching me when I struggled with concepts. Thank you, Papa, for teaching me many practical skills and, more importantly, for faithfully talking to me about salvation and other important spiritual issues. Thank you, Mr. Santos, for teaching me practical Spanish. And thank you, Mrs. Lytle, for faithfully teaching chapel. Thank you, Mr. Engel, for teaching physics and making classes like it available to homeschoolers. After graduation, I plan to work for Bangor Renovations for a year while taking Bible Institute classes. Please pray for me that God would give me wisdom as I seek His will for my life and that my choices would bring Him the glory that He deserves.
All right, next we're going to meet Stella Audrey Elbudo, so watch her video.
Hi, my name is Stella Elbudo. I was born and raised in a small country of Africa called Burkina Faso. My family moved to the United States in 2017 and I started attending ABA. Changing school and leaving all my friends and family behind was a hard challenge for me, but I quickly got used to things here, which partly thanks to Mr. Enger for always being patient, always willing to help whenever I need help. I have many great memories from ABA, but one of my favorite was the mission trip to Florida during the school year, because it was such an encouragement and blessing to me and others. For the longest time, I struggled with my salvation because I wanted to do things my own way. I truly never understood my need to have a personal relationship with God. He never stopped seeking after my stubborn heart till He finally could reach me. On June 20, 2021, I surrendered and gave complete control of my life to God and asked Him to save me because I knew I couldn't do things my own way any longer. Because looking back, I could see things that God used to bring me to a place of repentance and submission. I want to thank the whole staff for putting in all the hard work, which made my high school year memorable and enjoyable. Especially Mr. Fowler for being such a great encouragement and making math fun and enjoyable. And I also want to thank my dad for being such a godly example to me and my family. After high school, I'm going to attend Leha Corbin Community College in the fall. Please pray for me as I enter into this new chapter of my life, that God will continue to show His will for my life. Thank you.
Come on up, Stella. All right, next we're going to meet Celeste Ishimwe.
My name is Celeste Ishimwe. I was born and raised in the small nation of Burundi, and my family moved to America when I was 7 years old. I grew up learning about who God was, but I never really had a relationship with Him, and I knew nothing about salvation. It wasn't until I started to attend Lehigh Valley Baptist Church that I truly understood that I was not right with the Lord. However, I was in denial and wanted to keep indulging in the things I knew were not pleasing to the Lord. I began attending EBA when I was in ninth grade, and from that time until recently, I really struggled with my salvation, and at one point, I even made a false profession. However, on April 3rd, 2023, I surrendered my life to the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and turned from my sinful ways, and I was born again. Ever since then, I have seen a great change in my life as well as a hunger to serve the Lord. My favorite memory from this year was the missionary trip to Homestead, Florida. I was able to learn a lot about the ministry and a lot about myself. I realized that I was not right with God and I needed to fix that, so on the night of April 3rd, 2023, I surrendered my life to God and turned away from my sin. Ever since that day, I have seen many changes in my life and also many things I need to change about the way I was living. It truly is a blessing to have had the opportunity to go on the trip. There are many people I would like to thank for helping me get to where I am today, but especially Mr. Anger for his patience with me in school and for being a really great principal. I would also like to thank Pastor Gable for all that he has done to the youth group and for patient listening and answering to my questions. I would also like to thank Mr. and Mrs. Kine for their patience and their testimony, and Mrs. Kine for being with me on the night that I was saved. I would also like to thank Mrs. Kristen for being a wonderful example and for going through Bible study with me. Lastly, I would like to thank my mother for her patience with me and always supporting me in my decisions, as well as stopping me from making unintelligent ones. I am really thankful to have her in my life. My plans after high school include working a full-time job in the summer, as well as attending Lehigh Carbon Community College in the fall. Please pray for me as the Lord continues to work in my life. Thank you.
All right, Celeste, come on up. Next, we'll meet Leah Elizabeth Roan.
Hello, my name is Leah Elizabeth Roan. I have attended Emmaus Baptist Academy from kindergarten to 12th grade. I am very thankful for the impact this church and this school have had on my life. From a young age, I was taught what it was to have a personal relationship with God. And in May of 2018, after struggling with my salvation, and finally seeing who I truly was in God's eyes, I surrendered to Christ. I'm very thankful to God for never giving up on me before I was saved, and for never giving up on me now. I'm very thankful that He teaches me in love and mercy. I'm so thankful for all the experiences that I have had throughout my high school years. It was a blessing to me to be able to play volleyball, sing in all-state choir, go on a mission trip, and to go on many other field trips. These experiences were not only fun, but also taught me a lot. I want to say a big thank you to everyone who helped me get to where I am today. First of all, I would like to thank my parents for helping me all along the way. Thank you, Mommy, for always being willing to patiently listen to everything I say. Thank you, Daddy, for encouraging my love for learning and for being very happy to answer every question I have, no matter how obscure. Thank you, Abby and Sarah, for being willing to talk with me and laugh with me. Thank you to every single break monitor, supervisor, and teacher I've had over my 13 years of schooling. Thank you, Ms. Follett, for teaching me as a little kindergartner. Thank you, Mrs. Lytle, for teaching me in 4 years of my elementary and all of my years of elementary chapel. You taught me Bible verses and Bible principles that I will never forget. Thank you, Mrs. Hammond, for teaching the last 2 years of my elementary. I appreciate you taking the extra effort to create fun ways to learn. Thank you, Mr. Anger, for helping me with every subject from diagramming to geometry. Thank you for always pushing me to do more than the bare minimum and challenging me to strive for excellence. Thank you, Mr. Follett, for your genuine care for each and every student. Even when things were difficult, you were willing to give so much of yourself to help me succeed. Finally, thank you, Pastor Roland and Pastor Gable, for your consistent Bible teaching. You have shown me how a believer ought to live, not only by word, but by example. I'm very excited about what God can do with me in the future. I plan to attend Bible Institute in the fall and eventually get an education degree. Please pray for me as I seek to know and follow God's leading in the future.
right, we're going to watch a video about Ethan Starr, and then his parents are going to come up here and issue him their homeschool diploma.
My name is Ethan Starr. I have been homeschooled since kindergarten. I really enjoy being able to participate in many different activities with Emmaus Baptist Academy, such as basketball, numerous field trips, and singing at KCEA. One of my favorite memories was going to Washington, D.C., and walking around the city at night and visiting the different monuments and memorials. I also enjoyed attending classes such as Worldviews, Physics, and Small Engines. My favorite class was Physics with Mr. Anger and Mr. Jacobs. I really enjoyed learning practical things about creation, and I also enjoyed going up to the board to work out math problems. I also enjoyed being able to go to summer and winter Bible camps. Although I had been exposed to the Bible all of my life, these camps really caused me to focus on my relationship with God. It was at the summer camp of 2022 that God convicted me about my relationship with Him. After one of the messages about sin and delaying salvation, I was especially convicted and asked God to save me. Since then, I have seen God at work in my life, helping me to grow in His Word. I'd like to thank my parents for always emphasizing the importance of God and going to church. I also want to thank them for their continual love and care for me throughout my life. They have greatly influenced my life and walk with God. I'd like to thank Mr. Anger for helping to teach me and pushing me to experience new areas of ministry. I'd like to thank Pastor Gable for leading the teen group, as well as for discipling me and having long spiritual discussions after school. I'd like to thank Mr. Dotson for allowing me to participate on the basketball team and for coaching and teaching me skills that are useful both on and off the court. Finally, I ask for your prayers as I continue seeking the Lord's will for my future, as I possibly attend Bible Institute, and as I continue working through the summer. I would appreciate your prayers as I continue seeking the Lord's will for my life.
And now we're going to meet Julia Lee Wells.
Hello, my name is Julia Wells. I was homeschooled for kindergarten by my mother and started attending EBA in fourth grade. I grew up going to church and always hearing the gospel. I never really thought about God or salvation until I was in high school. At almost every church service, I would ask God to save me because I was scared my last profession didn't work. I never felt a difference, so I thought God was rejecting me. I became bitter toward God. I was done pretending to look like a Christian and started living my life my way. It wasn't until summer camp this past year that God showed me my sin. I wasn't ready to give Him full control of my life. On June 24th, 2022, I stopped running and gave my life to the Lord. I now know that I am saved. I'm so excited to see where God leads me in the future. There are many people I want to thank for getting me here, but especially I want to thank my parents for putting me through this school. I'm very thankful for a Christian school that taught me a biblical worldview through the preaching and teaching and through the teachers' testimonies. Thank you, Mrs. Lytle, for teaching me elementary in my beginning years. Thank you, Mrs. Hammett, for the long hours you put in to help me through the elementary years. Thank you, Mr. Anger, for your patience with our students and for teaching me math. Thank you, Mr. Follett, for helping me with all my math corrections, especially with my advanced math. I also want to thank Mrs. Gable for doing gym class. I really enjoyed all the self-defense classes and especially pushing your van. Thank you to all the other adults who have invested in my life and prayed for me along the way. My favorite memories of school and youth group are our trips. My favorites are the Washington, D.C. trip and the Florida trip. I plan on attending LTRIC to study criminal justice. I ask that you pray for me as I seek God's will for my life.
Come on up, Julie. All right, let's have the whole class come stand up front here, and while they're coming, let's give them a hand. Good job. While we're standing here, I'm going to have Brother Gable come and have a word of prayer in dedication of the class. Go ahead and pray for the food that we're going to have afterwards for those who are staying for the reception.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for this day. Thank you for these young people and the time that you have given us with them. I thank you for their parents and the investment they've made, and I thank you for the opportunity that you've given me to invest in them. And Lord, as we look to the future, we pray that you would help them, as we heard today, to prioritize their lives, to choose the right priorities and the right master and the right kingdom. And Father, I pray that they would go forth from this place serving you, fulfilling your will for their lives, because we know that your will is the best place. It is the place of happiness. It is the place of fulfillment. It is the place where you have made us to be. And I pray that you would help them to pursue after your will for their lives. Thank you for this day that we could celebrate together. And Lord, we thank you for those that came and enjoyed this occasion with us. We pray for every soul, Lord, that they would come to know you and have a personal relationship with you. Thank you for the celebration that we have to follow and the food, and bless it to our bodies and help us to have a wonderful time of fellowship today. Thank you again for who you are and allowing us to serve you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
All right, would you stand with me, and we're going to sing one song together. The song is "To God Be the Glory." Words are up here on the screen. Just give a couple closing instructions and we'll be dismissed. The seniors have each put together a display on the tables back here along this back wall. Lots of nice pictures, and there's some of them have little cards there where they invite you to write some advice for them. Leave it on their table. If you brought a card for some of them, they have baskets, I think, on their tables. You can drop a card in there. So if you are staying for the reception, and that would be those who RSVP'd, so everybody who's here was invited, and if you RSVP'd and said you would stay, then they prepared food and we encourage you to stay. And how we're going to do this, a little different than we normally do for church fellowships. You ready? We're going to come down this side aisle, but not go out the door, and then go in front of all of the tables, so you get a chance to greet the seniors, see their displays, and keep the line moving, and then go past and then out the middle doors there, and then go down in the foyer this direction, okay? So from the bathroom area and water fountain toward this end. And then you can exit at the door down there. There's lots of chairs, as you saw, set up outside where you can sit and eat in fellowship. If you got here early and you already got to see their displays, you're welcome to get to the head of the line of food and bypass standing in line here. But we encourage you to stop by and visit with the seniors on your way out. And then teens, we need your help over here to take down the handbells. You know where they go, back downstairs, and get the chairs all set up again. These seven chairs here can come down, so appreciate that. All right, thank you so much for coming.